Okay, so in my second lecture, what I want to explain in some detail is very surprising link between the Riemann hypothesis and the arithmetic side. So the arithmetic side, I don't have to introduce it. I introduced it in the first lecture. It's a very, very simple object. And the reason why it's related to the Riemann hypothesis is the following. So I don't recall the Riemann hypothesis. I suppose you all know or you all heard. And many of you are worried because, you know, many people say you first have to do analytic continuation, which is something ridiculous because I mean, the Riemann conjecture can be written as the fact that sigma of minus 1 to the n over n to the s is different from 0 for real of s in the half interval 1, okay? So, I mean, you don't need to do analytic continuation. This is well defined. Okay, so now it turns out that this Riemann hypothesis is actually equivalent by Weyl and also by Bombieri and other people to a negativity statement, which is very close to algebraic geometry in finite characteristic. And this negativity condition here is for real valued functions. This plays a very important role. But when you write down the quadratic form, this quadratic form is obtained by evaluating a certain distribution on the convolution of the function f and the function g when you look at it as a bilinear form. And the problem is the following. The problem is that this distribution is very, very, very strange looking. You know, this is a Mangold function, and there is a constant here in front of h of 1 because there is a finite value here. And this constant is log of pi, and this is the Euler constant. So how are you going to deal with that until you have a better understanding of this formula? Okay, I mean, what you need to do in order to have any chance is to have a geometric understanding of this formula. Now, this formula is related to what are called the explicit formulas. Of course, Riemann knew the explicit formulas. I mean, there is no doubt on that. And this explicit formula can be written for an arbitrary test function in terms of the Fourier transform, if you want, of this function here, and evaluation on zeros, and you get the same distribution which appears here with this Euler constant and so on. So, as it is, it doesn't look very promising, but thanks to André Weyl, André Weyl had a much better way of writing the explicit formulas. And because he wrote them in terms of Adels, and he wrote them for an arbitrary global field. So K is what is called a global field. And what is a global field? A global field is a field which has a parent, which is locally compact ring. And this parent is called the Adels. It's a parent because it sits inside the Adels in a way which is discrete and co-compact. And turns out to be essentially unique. I mean, I don't go into technical details, non-discrete whatsoever. But this is a definition of global field, so it's very natural and beautiful that André Weyl was able to rewrite the explicit formulas for an arbitrary global field. And then what is striking is that even though there is a delicate point because there is a principal value also there, the formula looks much simpler and much more unified because you have a sum over places of the global field, and the expression which is there is much better looking than it was before. So once one has this understanding of the explicit formulas, okay, it's very, very tempting, of course, to try to see these explicit formulas as a trace formula, like the Zellberg trace formula. And I mean, back very long ago, 22 years ago, I found an understanding of the explicit formulas as a trace formula. And I learned afterwards by Peter Sarnak that in fact Paul Cohen had been trying with the same space. And the reason why it's a very hard thing to do is the following, is that it's a general fact that the action of the multiplicative group of a global field on the Adels is actually ergodic. But what you can immediately understand, however, even though there is this very delicate problem, you can really understand how the local terms of André Weyl appear. They appear because if you look at the action by scaling of a local field on itself by multiplication, it's given by a Schwarz kernel. And the Schwarz kernel is just the Dirac, Dirac distribution of ux minus y, because if you do that, you will obtain xi of ux. And when you compute formally the trace, the distributional trace of this distribution, namely when you take x equals y, what do you get? You get the integral of delta of ux minus x, but you change variables and you find that it's 1 over u minus 1. So, and you see the module appearing, you see everything appearing fine. And so what happens then is that there was however one difficulty which was very different from the Zellberg trace formula, which is the minus sign here. You see, in the Zellberg trace formula, you make a sum over eigenvalues and so on. And on the right-hand side, you have a sum of geometric terms, but here there is a minus sign. And this took me a lot of time to understand. And I understood it because I know some physics. And I know that in physics, there are three kinds of spectra. There is a continuous spectrum. There is the emission spectrum, which happens when you take a chemical and you warm it up like sodium, you know, then it will emit rays. These rays will be seen as bright rays on a dark background. But the true spectra, which have been discovered first, were absorption spectra. And I mean, it's a German physicist, optician, Fraunhofer, that actually had the genius idea to look at the the light from the sun decomposed under a prism, to look at it with a microscope. And when he looked at it as with a microscope, he saw these absorption lines. Okay, first, of course, he thought that his objective was dirty or something like that. But at the end of the day, he had found 500 of them, and they are absorption lines. So it's absorption spectra. So with this idea of absorption spectra, and with the help of Ralph Meyer in 2005, okay, one can really understand the zeros, and in fact all zeros with the work of Ralph Meyer, as with a trace formula. Now, what about characteristic one? You see, there is in finite characteristics, there is something which is quite important for the geometry, which is the fact that the Riemann, the analog of the Riemann zeta function, is the Hasse-Weil zeta function. So it's a generating function of accounting, and it's counting the points of the curve, because a global field in finite characteristic is associated to a smooth curve. It's counting the number of points on the curve on a finite extension of the ground field, FQ. And so what happens in that case is that you have a generating function, and it looks like this, okay? And it turned out that for reasons which would be too long to explain, Soulet had the idea of generalizing the formula which holds for finite fields in the limit when q goes to 1. And he proposed the definition of a zeta function by taking this limit here. Okay? And then he did very simple calculations to show that the zeta function gave the right answer, for instance, for projective space, where the counting function when you work over a finite field FQ is given by a universal formula because it's a rational variety. So you have a universal formula which in fact makes sense for any Q. So he computed this, and then with Katia we said, wow, if there is a geometric object that underlies the Riemann zeta function, it should be such that when you compute this formula, you get the Riemann zeta function, the complete Riemann zeta function, including with the gamma factor at infinity. But then we had a problem. We had a problem, and the problem was the following, is that in the Soulet approach, when you write this q minus 1 to the power n of 1, n of 1 is the Euler characteristic of the variety. But if you think of the underlying geometric object for the Riemann zeta function, of course, it should have an H0 and an H2, which are one-dimensional, but it should have an H1, which is infinite-dimensional. So the Euler characteristic, which is supposed to be n of 1, should be minus infinity. So this formula didn't make sense. But then we had the idea of eliminating this term by taking the log of the two sides and taking the derivative in S. You see, if you take the log of the two sides and if you differentiate with respect to S, the term in q minus 1 to the n of 1 will disappear, okay? And what you will get, imagine that I take the log of this formula, okay, and I differentiate with respect to s when I put t equals q to the minus s. You agree with me that the r will drop out because I differentiate with respect to s, okay? There will be a minus sign. And what will I get? I will get, because I take the log, I will get the sum of n of q to the r times q to the minus s r, the r will have dropped down, okay, and it will be a sum over q. Now q goes to 1. What is this? These are the Riemann sums for an integral. Okay, so what we did with Katia is we replaced the formula of Soule by a formula with where now you no longer have this limit. It's very bad to have to take a limit when q goes to 1. So we replace the limit of the Riemann sums by the integral. Okay, and now the beauty is that now because we have replaced the Riemann sums by the integral, you can treat a case where n of u is no longer a function but a distribution. Okay, which is a big step. And it turns out that in order to solve it for the full Riemann zeta function, which is a complete Riemann zeta function, the answer is indeed a distribution. The answer is indeed a distribution. So we found with Katia that there is a distribution. Okay, this distribution is computed as a derivative of a function. And it turns out that this, when you write it formally as a derivative, it has exactly the same form as it has for finite fields, where for finite fields you would have the same contribution u and 1 as for projective space, but you would have the contribution of the zeros of the Frobenius. Okay, and here, however, one needs to be careful because you cannot put the d by du inside the parenthesis. You cannot differentiate the terms in the parenthesis, because if you do that, then it doesn't converge. Here it converges because you have 1 over rho plus 1, where the rho are the zeros of zeta. But if you put the derivative inside, it doesn't converge. So in fact, this distribution is a derivative of a function, and this function is approximable by what happens when you take the first 1,000 zeros. And when you take the first 1,000 zeros, you get this weakly curve. But if you take more and more zeros, you will get actually the final function. And why it is true that this is compatible with positivity? It's compatible with positivity because this function is increasing. How can it be compatible with the fact that n of 1 is minus infinity? Okay, because the function n is a derivative of this increasing function. And if you look at this function, how it goes near 1, you'll find that it shoots down to minus infinity. But it has a finite value at 1. So the derivative is minus infinity at 1. And that's how you get coherence. But this definitely indicates to us that there is a meaning for this q tends to 1. You see, I was talking about characteristic 1. I didn't have any justification for the Riemann zeta function. Here is the justification. Okay. Now the second step is that it turns out that if you look at the interpretation, okay, if you look at the what I told you before, which is the interpretation of the explicit formulas as a trace formula, then you can actually realize this counting function in a geometric way. So this function, n of u, is actually realized geometrically. Why? Because you just take the explicit formula, as it was written here, you just take the explicit formulas, and in this explicit formula, you take a suitable distribution, you compute the projection, I mean, because you are only computing fixed points in the quotient, not of adels by q cross, but you also divide by z hat cross. Why? Because you are only interested in the Riemann zeta function. You are not interested in two all L functions with Grossian character. So you divide by z hat cross, then you find exactly that the distribution which I had defined formally before is exactly given by the fixed points of the scaling action. So the action which is acting on this space, xq, is the action by scaling of the positive real numbers. So, sure. So the explicit formula is for all Grossian character, and my spectral realization and understanding is for all Grossian character. But now we concentrate on Riemann zeta, okay? And because we concentrate on Riemann zeta, we have to divide by z hat cross, okay? Which is this means that in general, a Grossian character will be a character over z hat cross. But here we take the trivial character, okay? All right. So now, at this point, you say, oh my god, it would be great if I could find a geometric space which has a Frobenius and in which this geometric space would coincide with this space and such that the action of the Frobenius would be the action by scaling. Of course, this is what we want, okay? Why is it a very difficult problem? It's a very difficult problem because this space is a non-commutative space, okay? So you can tell me, wow, okay, what does it mean that it's a non-commutative space? Well, this is a very simple definition. A non-commutative space like this is a space which has, if you assume the axiom of choice, it has the cardinality of the continuum. Okay, this is easy to prove. But there exists no constructible injection of this set into the real numbers. Why? And this is what was stopping Paul Cohen. Why? Because when you consider a measurable function on this space, it's almost everywhere constant by ergodicity. So the fact that the group Q cross is acting ergodically on adels tells you that it's impossible to construct an injection from this set into the real number. So the effective cardinality of this set is larger than the continuum. Now, how do you treat such spaces? Well, of course, I knew by cyclic homology how to treat it, so I knew how to find this explicit formula and all that. But now the miracle will happen, because the geometric interpretation and the geometric space and so on, it will be the arithmetic side. Okay, and what has happened is that in 2014, with Katia, we were working with the epicyclic category, and we had no idea that it would be connected with this stuff on the Riemann zeta function. We had strictly no idea. And then what happened was that what we have found is that, first of all, there is an object which is well known to people working in tropical geometry, which is well known to the Russian school of people working in the school of Maslow, the same Maslow as the Maslow index, who are doing what they call dequantization. And what did these guys found? What did they find? What did they find? They found a semi-field whose group of automorphisms is R plus star, is a multiplicative group of positive real numbers. And that's exactly what André Weil was asking in his TOQ paper. He was asking for some kind of Galois theory where, in fact, instead of having Galois groups which are profinite as usual, one would get the group which is a component of the ideal class group at the Archimedean place. Okay. Now, what is this R plus max? This R plus max has appeared perhaps in many contexts, but the first place where it appeared in a paper of Jacobi in the 19th century. When Jacobi was studying extremal problems, he was in fact manipulating a matrix of elements in R plus max and defining the determinant. So what is R plus max? R plus max is exactly you do for R the same thing as I was doing for Z to obtain Z max, okay? And you obtain R plus max, okay? So this is what it is. And it turns out that when you consider, of course, it's characteristic one, it's a deformation of the real numbers. So, I mean, you know, what happens is that this is why the Russian school, they call it the dequantization. Because what happens is that when you pass from quantum mechanics to classical mechanics, in fact, what you are doing, you are letting h bar go to zero. But h bar is always in the denominator of exponents. So in fact, what you are doing, you are raising two things to very high power and then taking the corresponding root. When you do that, you replace the sum by the soup. This is a very simple thing. Any analyst knows that because he knows the limit of LP norms is L infinity, which is the soup, okay? And you don't change the product. And then the big bonus is that the raising to the power x to the power x lambda is an automorphism, and there are no other automorphisms, okay? So that's a great discovery. What convinced me from this school of people is not this. What convinced me is something which I am still, you know, pa. What convinced me is that when you compute the analog of the Fourier transform in this setup, you find the Legendre transform. That's a beautiful fact, because the Legendre transform is something which you use all the time in thermodynamics and so on. There is another fact which is amazing also, which is that the Hamilton-Jacobi equation is not linear equation, it's a non-linear equation, but it's linear on R plus max. So you can superpose solutions. So it's a whole world. I mean, it's a world which we call the world of characteristic one. And now what is the theorem? The theorem is that if we take the points of the arithmetic site over this R plus max, okay? So, you know, if you have an algebraic variety, you can take its points over C. So now we take the points over R plus max. Our theorem contains two parts. It contains that the points over R plus marks of this topos, of the arithmetic site, form exactly the same double quotient that we had before, the space XQ. Moreover, the action of the Frobenius on R plus marks corresponds exactly to the action of scaling on the previous points. So we are in a kind of ideal situation, you know, where what we have is we have an analog of the Frobenius, and we have that there is a lot of support for this because we know that Q was going to 1. We know that we have the interpretation of the counting function, and we know moreover that, okay, now it's realized concretely by a geometry. Okay? So what is the picture at this point? The picture is still very rough. I mean, there is this arithmetic site. We can take its points over R marks or R plus marks, whatsoever. It gives us this Adel class space. There we have at our tools, analysis, non-commutative geometry. But now we have algebraic geometry here. And it's an exercise to see that spec Z maps to this. This is an exercise, okay. We have a translation. If you want, when you take a curve defined over FQ, we have the arithmetic site, which is defined over B. By the way, notice that the child, well, but the child would have been to be really clever. The child could have said to his father, "Father, there are no global sections." You know? So what am I saying? You know, the structure shift is Z max, okay, over this topos N cross. What are the global sections? They are the N cross invariant elements of Z max. There is nothing, 0 and 1, that's all. Okay, so I mean, it's amazing. It's amazing, the analogy is very, very close. So we have the structure shift, okay. We have the Galois group, which is acting on the points of the curve defined over FQ. But here, we have the Frobenius correspondences. So now we need to find the Frobenius correspondences on the arithmetic side. This doesn't look very promising at the start, because the arithmetic side is really a countable object. Remember, okay? I mean, it was Z max, and it was acting by N cross. Everything is countable. How on earth are you going to find this one parameter family of correspondences on it, okay? How does it work? Well, amazingly, it works. And how does it work? It works because what you do is you take Zmax and you tensor Zmax over B by itself. Okay, when you do that, what you will obtain, after some work, you will obtain what one calls Newton polygons. So the algebra that you will get will be an algebra of polygons like that. I mean, you know, and I put the upper part because this is what you have to think of. It's convex, okay? What are the rules? The rule of addition is taking two such polygons and taking the convex hull of the union. Okay? And what is the multiplication? The multiplication is the addition of the convex polygons. This is called Minkowski addition. Okay? I mean, so in that way you obtain a semi-ring. This semi-ring is of characteristic one. Okay? And it corresponds to the square. What about the correspondences? We are still in the countable domain here. Okay? Well, the correspondences are as follows. First, you compute the correspondences for the rational case, and you find rational lines like this one, like the diagonal, or like this one, and so on. But then you say, well, I can take the limit for an irrational number, for an irrational slope, of the rational ones. And then you have to prove a lot of stuff. But because we know Dedekind cuts allow to construct real numbers, so we shouldn't be surprised that different slopes give different correspondences, and they do. It's a lot of work, it's a lot of work. Then we can define the composition of correspondences, and what we found with Katia in a theorem is that when you compute the composition of correspondences, the composition is very, very simple if the product of the two numbers is not rational. Then it's really given by the law that you expect. I mean, it's a composition of correspondence in the sense of algebraic geometry. I mean, you do a tensor product and so on. Okay, so when the product is irrational, it's very simple. When the product is rational, it turns out that you have to perturb a little bit the result, because the idea is that if you have an irrational number, there is a little bit of room of flexibility. If you have a rational number, as soon as you touch it, you know, things will change. So you have to account for that. But okay, I mean, this is a, And it turns out that this rule is exactly the same as the rule of composition of divisors on spec Z with respect to S algebras that we found. So this is another indication of something. Sorry?
What is
Oh, tangential deformation, I don't have time to define. But I mean, it's a beautiful thing. Simple, beautiful. Okay. 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 So now what is the dream? What is the dream? The dream is that now one should be able to imitate the proof of Grothendieck and of Mathieu and Tate. I mean, you know, some people say Mathieu and Tate and they forget Grothendieck, while Tate said once, with Mathieu we missed the boat, you know. So I mean, the contribution of Grothendieck is quite important. So what is the idea? The idea of this proof of Mathieu, Tate, and Grothendieck is that in fact, to prove the Riemann hypothesis, you simply have to prove an inequality like that. That's a very simple fact. But in order to prove it, the only thing that you have to do is to prove a Riemann-Roch theorem on the square. Okay, so that's really what you need. On the other hand, we are still behind. Why? Because I told you that the non-commutative space, I mean, you know, the Hadelka space and so on, was obtained from the points of the arithmetic site over R plus max. But if you want to do algebraic geometry, you will never go far if you only have the points over an algebraically closed field. You need to extend the scheme to the algebraically closed field. Because then you will have a new structure shift and you will have a lot of things to work. Okay, so the next step that we did with Katia was to extend scalars. So we did the extension of scalars to R-max with the idea that once you have extended the scalars to R-max, the points over R-max will be unchanged, they will be the same, but you will have a new structure shift and you will have a lot more structure to go. Now, I must say one thing with respect to Laurent. You know, Laurent said the right thing after the talk of Olivia. But with Katia, we are probably a little bit too brave. Namely, we don't care to know if it's extension of scalars in a classical sense. We just did it, okay? Now, of course, I mean, it would have been better if we had taken 5 years and then we come, but okay, we just did it. Okay, and how did we do it? We did it by taking Z max and tensoring it over B by R max. Then we got some semi-ring. And we found that this semi-ring was not a semi-field, that it had some spectrum. We computed this spectrum by using the Legendre transform. And what did we find? We find that once we compute this spectrum using the Legendre transform, we find something which is very simple. This gave us the points. This gave us a topos. So this gave us a topos. This topos is the half line semi-direct product with n cross. So again, this is the first topos that I'm talking about, which is not a pre-shift topos. Okay, so it's not a pre-shift topos. Well, it's a topos which we call the scaling site. And it's a topos, if you want, which is the incarnation of what everybody does when they play music. Because when you play music, you play with frequencies, and you multiply frequencies because the ear is sensitive to multiplication by 2, by 3, but you know, okay. So that's what it is. And it's something which is extremely basic. I mean, you know, again, it's not as basic as the arithmetic site, but it's incredibly basic. Now, the beauty is the following, is that now you don't have to say that it's points over R plus max. Oui, Laurent, yes? I'm not sure it was. Yeah, I think it was.
You just mentioned it, but I want to stress the point that there is something quite puzzling for me here, because you see the points of the arithmetic site defined over a plus max.
Yes.
And for me, it is not the same thing as taking the semi-direct product. You see, you are considering the action.
What do you mean?
Yeah, you consider the action.
Yes.
Of n cross.
Yes.
Over
No, it's not what we do. You see, let me explain. You are talking about the corollary, eh?
So yes.
Yeah, okay, so let me first mention this, okay. So first of all, here, what we find is that irrespective of any definition...
No, I am talking about the meaning of the expression, the points of the arithmetic site defined over R plus max.
Yeah, yeah, but I come later to this, yeah. Okay? But okay. I will answer, okay.
What so is the precise meaning of this expression?
I will explain. Okay, so first of all, here, I mean, this is a clear statement. Here what you have is you take this topos, you take its points, so this you agree, okay. Now, what would have been a little bit bothering would have been that if we apply the same definition of points defined over something, okay, then we would have gotten a different answer than what we had before, okay. Now, what do I mean by points of the arithmetic site defined over R plus max? Well, I am thinking of the scaling site as an object over R plus max now. Over R plus max, and I take what is a point there, okay? So it's a point of the topos, but it's also a morphism of the local rings, of the local things. And the statement in the corollary is that there is only one such morphism, because it has to be R plus max linear. This is the idea. You see?
Okay, so this
yes. A point defined. Oh, it's not the arithmetic site. Oh. Ah, no, it's the same. The last sentence refers to the previous theorem. The last sentence refers to this. So, what is a point defined over R plus max? It's just a pair of a point of the topos.
How do you define
yes.
a point over something?
Well.
The arithmetic.
So I define a point over something, sure, so this something has to be an extension of the ground semi-field, okay? So I take it, okay? And then what do? I take a morphism of toposes, if you want, it will give me a point of the topos, okay? And it will give me a morphism going the other way from the local ring of the topos to the object in question, okay? It's in Grothendieck. It's a definition in SJF4 of a ring topos.
A morphism of ring topos.
Of course, yes. Of a morphism of ring topos, okay. Yes. So it's tricky, huh? It's tricky.
Yeah.
It's tricky to prove. It's tricky to prove.
So here you are talking
yes.
Yeah, in fact about okay. arithmetic topos.
Yes, yeah.
Together
yeah.
It's
yeah, sure, of course,
yeah, okay.
of course. Okay. I use all this, okay?
Okay?
Whereas in the other statement, this is a very important discussion, in the other statement, I don't need, for the first statement, any structure sheaf or anything. I mean, these are just the points of the topos, okay? And
yeah.
as, okay?
Yeah, for this.
But it's also, now here, when I say, if I look at the points of the topos here, but I can also look at the points of this topos over R plus max. I can also do that. They all coincide.
Okay.
So all the three coincide. And of course, you know, it's one has to check many details, but it all works. Okay? Okay, so what about the structure sheaf now? What you find, what is the big plus that you get after having extended scalars? Well, you get an enormous big plus because now you have a structure sheaf. So now, in the Adel class space, instead of having a naked space, you have a structure sheaf, okay? So you have the Adel class space, but you have a structure sheaf. And what is amazing is that this structure sheaf, again, could have been introduced many years ago. It could have been introduced, why? Because there are theorems of localization of zeros of analytic functions, which in the PID case takes this form, and in the real case, complex case, takes this form. And what do they do, these theorems? What do they say, these theorems? They say that the zeros of an analytic function, when you look at their valuations or when you look at their absolute values, they are obtained by taking what is called the tropicalization of the function. And this tropicalization is actually a section of the structure sheaf of the scaling site. So it's a function which is piecewise affine with integral slope, and the zeros correspond to the place where you change the slope. Now, this type result is already a very good sign because it relates the zeros of an ordinary analytic function with the topos, which is the scaling topos. Okay. By the way, I want to mention here one thing which I learned recently. I didn't know that Jensen had thought he had proven the Riemann hypothesis using his localization formula. I mean, I didn't know that at all. Okay, so where are we now? So now, if you want, we have already extended scalars to like to FQ bar. We have the scaling site. We have the points which are the same in both cases, like I was saying. We have the structure sheaf, which is formed of convex piecewise affine functions with slopes in Z. And of course, now, because we have this structure sheaf, we can look at the sheaf of fractions. You know, when you do, the, when you do of course, algebraic geometry for a curve and so on, you are not content, of course, with the structure sheaf. What you have to do is you have to pass from the structure sheaf to the sheaf of fractions. And it is the sheaf of fractions that gives you the divisors and everything. Okay, so that's the situation at this point. That's the situation at this point. And of course, you know, what is the hope? The hope is that, well, somehow we have the correct algebraic geometric framework in order to imitate the proof of Matuk, Tate, and Grothendieck. So this is the hope. Eh? This is the hope. But now, in general, when you have a hope like that, you first have to look at simpler situations and try to understand them. And what you want in this setup is to prove Riemann-Roch formulas. So what we need, if you want, is to prove Riemann-Roch formulas. I can tell you why. Why you just need Riemann-Roch formulas. Okay, so RR, if you want, Riemann-Roch formulas. Well, because you see, the proof of Matuk, Tate, and Grothendieck is incredibly simple. You want to prove that this thing, S of FF, is actually negative or zero. Okay, so what do you do? You assume that S of FF is actually strictly positive. Okay, now you prove that by some consideration, you write an index formula where the right-hand side of the index formula is 1/2 of S of FF. Okay, and here what you have is dimension of H0 of some divisor D, minus dimension of H1 of D plus dimension of H2 of D, okay? And this D is some divisor, okay, which is associated to F, okay? Now, if you have a formula like that, and if this is positive, then what you will find out is because this term is negative always, either this is positive or this is positive. By some kind of third duality, you can always say this is positive. So assume this is strictly positive. If this is strictly positive, it means that this divisor can be made effective. It can be made effective. And once this divisor is effective, then actually you get a contradiction. You get a contradiction because you intersect it with a vertical or horizontal correspondence, and you get a contradiction. So in that way, this is the way Grothendieck proved, if you want, with the idea of Matuk Tate also, how he proved the Riemann hypothesis in the case of Weyl. And so it's obvious that the next step is Riemann-Roch formula. So what we did with Katia, was to, so this is the actual situation, a little better than before, because now we have the scaling site, which is obtained by extending scalars. We have this S, this is the sphere spectrum, which is at the base. And we have the points, we have all this story here, which is now a little bit richer, okay? So it's a little bit richer, sorry. So what we did with Katia, in order to prepare for Riemann-Roch formulas, we concentrated on the easy part of the Adel class space. And the easy part of the Adel class space is the image of spec Z. It is a periodic orbit. Okay, so it turns out that in this space, the space which I described to you, these points and so on, there are periodic orbits. And these periodic orbits, in fact, it turns out, if you want, that the points, the best way to understand the points as a non-commutative space are just rank one subgroups of R. Rank one subgroups of R. Of the real line. I mean, you know, if you tell somebody that the space of rank one subgroups of R is a non-commutative space, they will think you are a little bit nuts. But this is the truth, okay? I mean, it's not possible to embed the space of rank one subgroups of R in the real numbers by an injective map, okay? However, there are nice subspaces, and the nice subspaces which is associated to a prime is when you take the rank one subgroups which are isomorphic to the group HP, and HP is a group of rational numbers which have a denominator which is the power of p. So when you take a group like that, Okay, when you take subgroups which are isomorphic to that, they form a space, and as a space, this space is a circle, and this circle is r plus star divided by the powers of p. Okay, divided by all powers of p. That's what it is. R plus star divided by p to the z. And you recognize in that space the log p, which is in the explicit formulas. So the length of this circle is log p. Okay? The length of this circle is log p. Now, you can concentrate on this circle because this circle is much easier to understand than the full non-commutative space. And the idea that we had with Katia is to take the analogy with the Jacobi elliptic curve. When I say Jacobi elliptic curve, Jacobi was able to understand elliptic curve in that way, and Tate showed that this is the right way in the periodic world. The right way in the periodic world is not to divide C by a lattice, but it's to do it like this. So what we did, we built a dictionary, okay, so we had the analog of the functions, periodic functions, in the case of Jacobi. In our case, it's piecewise affine functions which are convex for the structure shift, but when you pass to the shift of fractions, you get arbitrary functions, no longer convex. And now they are global sections. And so, I mean, I will pass rather fast on that. I don't want to spend too much time on that. However, it turns out that one can really do algebraic geometry like you would like to do. So if you want, first of all, you pass to the shift of fractions, and when you look at the shift of fractions, what you obtain is that whereas before the addition of piecewise affine convex functions was given by the supremum, this continues to hold for the shift of fractions even though the functions are no longer convex. So the shift of fractions, if you want, is formed of differences of convex functions, but the operation is still the supremum, okay? And so, I mean, this is very nice. And then you find out that the correct notion of divisor is exactly the notion which was invented by Cartier. You see, when I told you that the zeros of this function were the place where the function was changing slope, you could say, what is your conceptual explanation for that? I mean, it doesn't seem, you know, it seems completely ad hoc. So why is that true? It is true because if I think of these functions as Cartier divisors, if I think the associated Cartier divisor, where the function is affine, it is trivial because it is in the invertible elements. It's convex and its minus is also convex, okay? So it's like the function is convex and the inverse is also convex. Okay, but when I'm around this point, it's no longer true. It's no longer true. So there is a non-trivial class modulo the affine functions, and it turns out that this non-trivial class modulo affine functions gives you exactly the notion of the order of the function at the point. And it turns out that the order of the function at the point, it's a real number. It's no longer an integer. That's already a big surprise. It's not an integer. It's a real number. And then you can define a divisor. So a divisor is, the definition is more or less obvious, but it's a Cartier divisor. So you define the divisors. And when you define the degree of a divisor, you find that the degree of a divisor is a real number. Bah! That's boo, you know? Okay? And moreover, you prove that the degree can be arbitrary real numbers. This is very new. I mean, you know, this is totally new. And why should it be there? Because when you write the Riemann positivity, you no longer deal with integers now, you deal with real numbers. So it's essential that something like the degree, something like the right-hand side of the explicit formulas and so on is a real number. So the degree is a real number. And then what we proved with Katia is that, of course, there is a notion of principal divisor, which is associated to global sections. But what we proved, and this was a very frightening type of proof, we proved that if you take a principal divisor, the degree is zero. Okay, better be zero, of course, but it's true. Okay, so the degree of a principal divisor is zero. And moreover, there is another invariant of a divisor. It turns out that there is another invariant of a divisor, which is an element of a finite group. The finite group is Z modulo P minus 1Z. So this group will distinguish different primes, so which means that these elliptic curves under quote in characteristic one will be non-isomorphic for different primes, okay? So what we get at the end of the day for this part is that we can completely compute, if you want, the Jacobian. And so we have computed completely the quotient of divisors by principal divisors, and we have obtained that it's R cross this finite group, okay? And then we have developed the theory of theta functions, because if you know elliptic curves, you know that the theory of elliptic curves depends crucially on the fact that you can write everything extremely concretely by means of theta functions. Okay, so we have developed theta functions. For that, we have followed Jacobi. So we have translated the formulas of Jacobi, or of Tate, if you want, immediately into formulas in characteristic one. And then we proved that any global section, so any rational function, can be canonically decomposed in terms of theta functions. Okay, so this is a technical step, if you want. And the key fact now will be Riemann-Roch. Okay, for the periodic orbit. So the way Riemann-Roch comes in, it's beautiful in the sense that you can define H0 by the usual story. So you define, for a divisor, you define H0 to be all solutions of this inequality with respect to the divisor. You prove that it's an Rmax module for obvious reasons. But you are not done. You are not done now. Now you have a big problem. You have a big problem because what you find out is that if you look at the ordinary Rmax module of solutions for the simplest divisors, it's infinite dimensional. It's infinite dimensional. In all possible ways of dimensions that you could define, it's infinite dimensional. Okay? And what is the reason? The reason that now, on this periodic orbit, the slopes are no longer required to be integers. They can be any number which has a denominator p to the n, so you're stuck. So what do you do now? You say, well, why did I have something finite dimensional before? Because z is discrete in R. So now I have this group. It's not discrete in R, but it's discrete in qp cross R. So now I'm going to filter the solution space by the slopes in a periodic norm. Okay, so you do that, and what you obtain a filtration of the space of solutions in function of the periodic norm of the denominator, so of the periodic norm of the solution. It's extremely natural, adelically speaking. It could be recast, adelically speaking. And then what you find, you define the real value dimension exactly as von Neumann defined real value dimension, or Dixmier defined real value dimension. So what will be the dimension of the space of solution? It will not be, of course, the topological dimension of the space of solution, because this is infinite, but it will be the limit when n goes to infinity of p to the minus n times the topological dimension of the space of solutions. And the topological dimension is how Riemann was defining it, namely the number of parameters on which a solution depends. I mean, in fancy terms, you can talk about the Lebesgue dimension and so on, but I mean, this is really the Riemann dimension. So, and of course, you know, it was impossible. It would have been impossible to obtain a Riemann-Roch theorem without a definition like that, because you need the dimension to be a real number. Okay? You need the dimension to be a real number. And it's von Neumann, with the theory of type 2 factors, that discovered real dimensions. You know, it's really von Neumann who did that. And so this is an imitation of von Neumann in characteristic 1. But if you look at the analog of this formula in characteristic 0, it was done by Dixmier. And this ties up with the talk of Olivia about MV algebras, because it corresponds to a certain lattice ordered group, which is exactly this one. Okay, so then we proved the Riemann-Roch theorem. So the Riemann-Roch theorem that we proved for periodic orbits with Katia is this formula. In that case, of course, it's just the degree, and there is no, so it's the simplest type of Riemann-Roch formula. It's always finite. Always finite. Yeah, and it can be any real number. I mean, what I said before is that the degree of a divisor can be any real number. So you would have no chance to obtain a Riemann-Roch theorem if you didn't have a formula like this, because you have to have all real numbers to be obtainable. You know, so I mean, it would be impossible. Okay, so now we have to go back to the goal, and our goal with Katia is to obtain a Riemann rock on the square. Now, when we met this problem, we said, wow, okay, let's develop homological algebra in characteristic one, okay? And we are already at the title for the paper, we would call it the semi-toku. I don't know if you understand, because, you know, the great paper on homological algebra is the toku paper of Grothendieck. So semi-toku meant, you know, toku for semi, semi stuff, and so on. And we worked, okay, we worked like crazy for 1 year or more. Okay, we wrote a very hard paper. But at the end of the day, we couldn't find a good definition of the H1. Namely, you know, we have a lot of theory and so on, but, it demanded so much adaptations of so many concepts. I mean, one doesn't realize how many concepts are actually used, you know, when one does homological algebra. I mean, it's amazing. We found a relation, of course, with Grandis, with the work of Grandis, which was extremely helpful. So we went quite far. We showed that there were derived functors, which are much more difficult to define because they are defined by the Kahn construction. I mean, so we did a lot of work. But at the end of the day, we said, okay, well, you know, we could spend the rest of our life trying to develop homological algebra in characteristic one. And you know, okay, still very far. So and then we got an idea. And what is this idea? Well, okay, this I won't insist. I mean, you know, we found, in fact, that there was a reason why it was so difficult because of what happens in the tropical Riemann-Roch theorem. It's not really a Riemann-Roch theorem. It's just an existence part of Riemann-Roch. So with Katia, we decided, we found something, another idea. And the other idea is that because of the Jensen formula, it's possible to make what we call a tropical descent technique. And what is this tropical descent? The tropical descent technique is the following, that if you have a situation in characteristic one, where it's very hard to do homological algebra, what will you do? You will sort of quantize the situation. You will lift it in characteristic zero over the complex numbers. Now, over the complex numbers, you will use the ordinary Riemann-Roch-Hirzebruch type of result. But how will you go down? Well, you will go down by the Jensen formula. So it turns out that the Jensen formula is exactly a formula which tells you that if you have a solution of the Riemann-Roch problem upstairs, when you tropicalize it, it will give you a solution downstairs. That's an amazing fact, okay? Yeah, yeah, okay, so wait a second. Of course, so what we wanted to find, so as I said here, you know, it's the existence part of the Riemann-Roch formula in the tropical, okay, it follows from the analytic geometric version. And of course, if you work in characteristic zero, you can open any book, now, you know, index theorem, whatever, bah, you get it, okay? Now, so what is the tropical descent? The tropical descent is the following. It's the fact that if you take a function which is holomorphic in an annulus, and if you tropicalize it by this formula, then it turns out that for the zero of the function is exactly the zeros of the tropicalization when you map it by log of absolute of z. So the tropical descent tells you that if you have a solution upstairs of a divisor problem, I mean of a Riemann-Roch problem, you will get a solution downstairs. And we first tried. So we first tried. And the first try that we had for quantizing, for lifting the scaling site, was very simple. What was it? It was to take the disk, punctured. So take the punctured disk, okay? And think about the Jensen formula for the punctured disk. What does it mean? It means that you map a point from the punctured disk to zero infinity. So, and when I say the disk, I say closed disk, but I have removed zero. So the boundary is there. So I can take a point in the disk and I can map it to zero infinity by minus log q. What is the point now? The point is that the action of n by multiplication on the scaling side lifts. It lifts to z, goes to z power n. And the Jensen formula is compatible with this formula. So if in the Jensen formula you replace f of z by f of zn, you actually have exactly the right operation on the shift downstairs. So this is beautiful. And it gives us a first hint for the lift of the topos. Okay, so it gives us this first hint of the topos, which is the disk, punctured disk, cross product by n cross. Okay, so this was the first hint. But it turned out that things, of course, had to be more difficult than that. Why? Because when you write the Riemann thing and so on, you have divisors which are integrals of Frobenius correspondences. Okay, so they are integrals. They are not finite sums or anything like that. And the Jensen formula, when you take the Jensen formula, it will only give you this type of function, which are piecewise affine. It will never work. We need convex functions which are arbitrary. Where did we find them? We found them in a theory which was also invented to try to solve the Riemann hypothesis. It's a theory of almost periodic functions by Bohr, Tourneave, and Jensen, and all that. And we found the solution there. So what is the solution? Solution is the following. It's almost periodic analytic functions. So it turns out that when you take the Riemann zeta function, okay, and you write it, if you restrict it to a vertical line, it's a function which is not so bad. It repeats itself. Why it repeats itself? It repeats itself very much because it's like n to the power it, you know? So take it in the domain of convergence to simplify. So if you take sigma of 1 over, I don't know, n to the 1 plus epsilon plus it, okay? You see that this function is really almost periodic. So it repeats itself, okay? And because it repeats itself, of course, you are not going to take the same formula as Jensen, you are going to take the Jensen theory. And what is the Jensen theory? You, instead of taking the integral of the function from minus infinity to infinity, because it repeats itself, you have to normalize it by 1 over 2t. So you take the same formula and you do that. And what did Jensen, Tourneave, and Bohr, and so on, and what did they prove? They proved that now, the function which was here, the tropicalization, is an arbitrary convex function. Amazing. And when you take the number of zeros, it's not the number of zeros that counts, it is the density of zeros. So what they proved, it's a beautiful result, they proved that the limit when t goes to infinity of the density of zeros, so I mean of this, you know, the number of zeros divided by 2t, is equal to the variation of the derivative of the function. So here, of course, it was the variation of the derivative of the function, but now the variation of the derivative of the function can be a real number. You see, the function is still convex, can be a real number, but it gives you the density of the zeros. Beautiful, beautiful idea, beautiful idea. And with this idea, actually, they proved something. They were able to prove something which, for people, you know, many times I receive proofs of the Riemann hypothesis, and people ask me to find a mistake, and I make money with this. I even made $2,000 with this, you know, recently, I mean. So. But let me tell you one tool that you can have, which is very good. Because these people prove something. They prove that if instead of writing zeta of s equals zero, you know, imagine that I write zeta of s equals 0.00. One, okay? Imagine I write that. Okay, now you won't believe that what these people prove is that solutions to this equation are infinite. So if I take the strip, which goes, so this is real part 1/2, this is real part 1. Now, what they prove is that the densities of solutions of this equation in this strip tends to infinity when the strip goes to 1/2. So there are infinitely many zeros of this equation which coalesce to 1/2. This shows you, you know, the incredible difficulty of the problem if you try to solve it by direct attempt. I mean, you know, it's the wilderness of this function is something absolutely amazing. And it was proved using this technique, okay? It was proved using this technique. So we know that this technique should be very good for us, okay? Now, using this idea, we found a better solution, much better solution, okay? And what is this better solution? Okay, what is this better solution? It turns out that this better solution is to make the imaginary direction almost periodic. Now, what does it mean to make the imaginary direction of the function almost periodic? In fact, when you turn to the Poincaré disk and all that, when you cover the disk, you find that what you are doing, you are compactifying the angular direction after making it with a universal cover. So in fact, you are taking the parietal cover of the disc, of the punctured disc. Okay, so you are taking the parietal cover of the punctured disc, and then okay, you try to work with this business. So at the topos level, this is the last topos that you will see. Okay, it's a topos which is a ring topos now. So you know it's a very classical type of object. And what is it? It is the punctured disc, but then you take the parietal cover, and on this space now, you do something which is very tricky. Namely, what you do is you extend scalars from the complex numbers to what we constructed with Katia, which we call the analog of the Witt construction characteristic one, which is an extension of the complex numbers, but which allows to define the arithmetic Frobenius correspondences. So, I mean, of course, this is now very technical. It's contained in our paper, which we put on the archive about 2 weeks ago. And now it turns out that what I was telling you just... Yes? Sorry? Yeah, exactly, yeah. So what we have shown with Katia is that it's possible now to, if you want to go to this big picture, which is here, because here I gave you the topos picture, but it turns out that there is also the analog analysis picture. And this analysis picture turns out to be very beautiful, because now it turns out that the complex space that you get is actually a moduli space of elliptic curves. They are elliptic curves which are endowed with an additional structure which we call a triangular structure. And the fact that it's a non-commutative space comes from the fact that we take these elliptic curves up to isogenies. So what it means is that now, for the function theory, we are able to use modular forms, we are able to use modular functions and all that. They are all in the basket, if you want. So that's where we stand, okay? That's where we stand, essentially. There are many properties that we are exploring and so on. And our hope, but okay, you know, we had so many times where the hope was still very far. So our hope is that standard Riemann-Roch formula on a two-dimensional, you know, manifold, but extended with extended scalar like this, should be able to do the job. And okay, we can define the Frobenius correspondences, you know. But that's where we stand. I don't want to spend too much time there. I think we reached the picture. But what I would like to say, if you want, is that, I mean, I don't think one could go at all on the algebraic geometry side without the idea of the topos. The idea of the topos in all of what I have explained is playing a fundamental role, you know. You couldn't even speak about what you have without the idea of a topos. So this idea, you know, I am, of course, you know, I have created a non-commutative geometry, and some people could say that I am sort of giving up and going to topos theory. Oh, this is not true, because the two theories are extremely related to each other. And essentially, they study the same object, but non-commutative geometry studies them at the level of the Langlands side, or you know, at the level of the automorphic side, whereas the topos studies them at the combinatorial level, at the Galois side, at the Artin side, and so on. And the two speak to each other, of course, but they are not the same. They are not the same. But I mean, yes. Well, what I say is the following: that if you want non-commutative geometry as it was developed and so on, uses Hilbert space as a key ingredient and so on, and so it's really sitting on the automorphic side. Whereas, and it uses the complex numbers. If you want, the non-commutative geometry has been developed from quantum mechanics and so on, using the complex numbers as a key ingredient. So this is common with the Langlands program. Now, on the other side, you have the topos, and of course, you know, there are, it's stupid to say a theory is better than another one. It's like saying a mathematician is better than another one. This is a type of stupidity that we hear all the time. But what is beautiful on the topos side is that an idea like the type of ideas that Olivia was explaining could make a big breakthrough. Why? Because imagine that for a while, you are totally naive and you develop things ignoring the action of N-cross. But you do it in a constructive manner. Okay. Then you apply the amazing fact that anything that you have proved, you know, for sets and all that, will continue to work over any topos. Now you put in the end cross. Ah, here we are, you know. So this is what I believe. I mean, I believe that as an intellectual tool, the topos idea is a fantastic tool because of all its potential to make you think in the right way. Make you think in the right way. By the way, when I started my talk, I hope you recognized a well-known saying of Feynman. Feynman said, think different. Okay? That's what he said. But he also said something. He also said something else, which, you know, for people working in topos theory is extremely useful. He said, what do you care what other people think? Okay, I think I will end up.